Pharaoh's army, including all his four strong chariot and cavalry, caught up with them as they were setting up their camp by the sea of Pihor, facing north. As Pharaoh approached, the Israelites looked up and saw the Egyptians were coming at them. You know, when you think about things and chaos in the world, and specifically in this story, do you think as the people were fleeing, do you think they left the elderly behind? What about that mom with the infant who was difficult to make that journey? What about the 12 small children? I don't believe so. I believe that they loved each other so much that they took time to care for each other on that journey. As that child may have tripped and fell, someone who loved picked them up and loved them. So in all of our situations, I believe that the love for each other will hold us together. So we're going to sing Hold Us Together. But guess what this morning, guys? The words are on the screen. So you get to stand and participate. Let's get excited about praising the Lord this morning. Let's get excited. Sing with us. So we're not just singing. You sing with us. Let's participate in worship together. Join us as we sing. Hold us together.
This is the first day of the rest.
land. Terrified, the Israelites cried out to the Lord. They said to Moses, "Did you bring us out into the desert to die because there were no graves in Egypt? Look what you have done by bringing us out of Egypt. Didn't we tell you in Egypt, leave us alone. Let us go on serving the Egyptians. It would have been better for us to serve the Egyptians than to die in the desert." Do we ever get caught up in that pity party for me? But listen, continue. Moses answered the people, "Don't be afraid. Stand still and see what the Lord will do to save you today. You will never see the Egyptians again. The Lord is fighting for you. Be still." Sometimes we just need to be still and bask in His amazing. Let's sing.
Thank you. as we kind of get started today, I'm wearing a shirt, and somebody said, "Greg, did you really need to wear that today?" It says the church has left the building. Well, I want to go back to think about Friday. Friday was 9/11, and we say a lot about 9/11. Always remember, or never forget. That was a significant day in our country. But I saw something that I liked a lot. They talked about that, and several people have mentioned, as much as we need to remember 9/11, really what they want back is 9/12. When there was a sense of unity, when there was a sense of coming to God, when there was a sense of gathering, when there was a sense of there was no division among us. Well, you know, I feel kind of the same way today about us coming back into this building. And it's an exciting time. This building is a blessing that God has given us. It's a, there were people that sacrificed tremendously for us to be able to come into this wonderful place that we have. But in the midst of that, I also don't want us to forget what we have come through. We haven't been in this building to worship as we're doing today. It's still a different day than it was last time we worshiped. I think, when was the last time? Was it the end of February, 1st of March? And so things have changed. There are a few things I want to talk about. Things have changed. We are different. Our calling is more focused. And we can't go back to where we were. And so the church has left the building is something I want us to remember. We still have this building. The building is still something God will use for His benefit. It's a wonderful place for us to be. But I think there's some things God has shown us in the midst of our time together that was challenging that we need not to forget. And I want to share a scripture with you today. And if you are looking on, some of you may be looking at your outline, and you're going to say, "Greg, that doesn't really go along with your outline." It's one of those times that it doesn't happen very often, but I had spent some time preparing, and in the midst of pulling things together, God led me towards another scripture. So instead of the crossing of the Red Sea, which is in your notes today, if you look online and you wanted to follow the notes that are there, it's going to be different. I'm going to be reading instead from John chapter 20, verse 11 through 18. And I was focusing on the miracle of the crossing of the Red Sea, but today instead we're focusing kind of on following up on what I know is the greatest miracle of all time, and that's the resurrection of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. So we look at John chapter 20, beginning with verse 11, and I'll be reading through verse 18. "But Mary stood outside the tomb crying. As she wept, she bent over to look into the tomb and saw two angels in white seated there where Jesus' body had been, one at the head and the other at the foot. They asked her, 'Woman, why are you crying?' 'They had taken my Lord away,' she said, 'and I don't know where they put him.' At this time, she turned around and saw Jesus standing there, but she did not realize that it was Jesus. 'Woman,' he said, 'why are you crying? Who is it you're looking for?' Thinking he was the gardener, she said, 'Sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you put him and I will get him.' Jesus said to her, 'Mary.' She turned toward him and cried out in Aramaic, 'Rabboni,' which means teacher. Jesus said, 'Do not hold on to me, for I have not yet returned to the Father. Go instead to my brothers and tell them I am returning to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God.'" Lord, as we read the scripture, as we consider today what Mary's experience was, may we find what you desire to communicate to us today, the relevance today, the message today that you have for us. And Lord, while it's something we receive, enable us to embrace it in such a way that we're able to worship you more fully. Lord, this is still a worship service, a worship opportunity. And Lord, you are our audience. And so we're going to spend time now worshiping you through your word. But Lord, then we're going to come up, we're going to sing some more. Help our hearts just to continue to get more and more full at the blessing that we realize that you're giving us. And so our worship can't help but be genuine and forthcoming and enthusiastic. God, we thank you for loving us. We love you and just all the blessings that are incorporated in that that you give us every day. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So, the first thing I talked about is that we do church differently. We're doing church differently now. There are many of you right now on Facebook, and I'll start with you. You're probably before this time, how often did you really do church? How often did you worship? How often were you engaged with the body of Christ sitting on your couch? Maybe even reclining in your bed. Maybe sitting at the breakfast table with your phone propped up in front of you. Maybe with your family gathered around the TV in the living room and watching it through a video feed. It's different. But you know what is amazing about that? Is that maybe, just maybe, there's a sense that God has entered the personal spaces of our life in a way he never has before. Is that a possibility? Is it really possible that God takes something that we didn't desire, that we couldn't see was intended that way, and he takes it for something that benefits us in a greater way than we could have ever imagined? And so instead of, and we know we don't typically say it, that church is about a building, we know it's not that. But when we begin on a regular basis, for those of you who've been connected to Facebook, to regularly experience the message of God, to experience worship in the midst of your home, it maybe becomes to a point that God feels like he's more a part of everything that's happening within that home. That's a beautiful thing. So that's one thing that I believe some of us at church are doing differently. Another one is our outdoor worship that we've been having for weeks, months. And what I think that helped us to see is that God is bigger than a building. God is bigger than a room. But more than just the nature and the wonderful experience there, because I heard a lot of people say it's just amazing to be outside at times. We need to realize it's not just about nature. God is bigger than anything we can comprehend. And that bigness should impact the way we're able to worship, the way that we serve as a church. So that's another way that I believe God is changing things about us as a church. Another one is that I know we are, I can give you examples, in fact I will as we go along, but this church is experiencing God in new and refreshing ways that are relevant to us as a church, relevant to who God has called us to be, relevant to us as individuals. And it feels so good. And you know what I was reminded of a couple of weeks ago? There are some people that in the midst of this, and because we're not doing church, and maybe they're not connected in some of the ways that I've seen God working, just in part, maybe because I'm pastor of the church, that it's possible to almost get down and depressed about the church, and is the church really being the church anymore, and are we losing something, and are people not connected like they used to be? Tell you, if we're willing to follow, if we're willing to pay attention, if we're willing to engage, God has not lost any ground whatsoever. And if we pay attention, we're able to go there and be a part of that, and it's exciting. And I believe wholeheartedly, as we continue in that direction, that we can be better for the struggle and the challenges that we go through. We can understand more clearly who God is calling us to be. And this, what else we're doing differently as a church, we're realizing more than ever before that the church, the way we're changing, isn't just about Sunday morning. Because there are a lot of things. Seminary did not have a class on the 2020 pandemic. It just did. They failed me in that regard. And and every pastor I know, every church leader I know. There was nothing taught to us about that. But God doesn't let us. God is leading us. And so we're searching and we're seeking for something that nobody is able to tell us from this experience, because nobody has experienced this before. But it causes me, and hopefully us as a church, to rely on God in a way that we never have. So it's not just a church thing about something. There's also another thing about the way that we're doing church differently, and that's our community connection. There's a strong sense of connection that I feel Woodland. And I need to let you know that and communicate that to you, because you need to be able to get excited and enthusiastic about that too. We, as a body of believers, are more aware of the spiritual needs around us. The first one, and probably the most obvious one from the get-go, was our preschool, our well center, Woodland Early Life Learning Center. And from the get-go, we were some of one of the few people that never, except for 2 weeks, I think, never closed during the pandemic. And we struggled with that. We wanted to know what the right thing was to do, and we prayed about it, and we met, the committee met about it, talked about it. There was so much that went into that. And then we realized, and teachers realized, that at that time when it first started, they didn't know how dangerous that was going to be, but they were willing to make a sacrifice. And it meant they still were coming and having a job, so that was a benefit. But more than that, they were willing to be available for essential personnel who had to work so that there would be child care when so many other places weren't. And there was not just coming in doing things like they always get done. I told you nobody prepared me in seminary for this. Nobody prepared a preschool for what they had to face as they were moving into that. And it was challenging. And it was a struggle. But they were there for our community and for our families when there was a time of need, and they continue to be. And that's carried over too, even now. Families that are part of our well center that have grade school kids, we regularly have people, students here every day during the week who are virtually participating in school while their parents are somewhere else, and we've adapted. We have done that. We have other teachers who aren't teaching, but they're there and available to just support and encourage as students are having an opportunity to learn and engage. And we're able to be a part of that and encourage that and invest in these students and families. Another one is that we're taking initiative, I believe, like never before, to get involved. We are recognizing basic needs of people around us, particularly as a result of the pandemic and struggles and challenges that people have had. And we're meeting those needs where they're hurting. There's also spiritual needs that we're aware of. I want to tell you two specific, and I don't know if this happened because of the pandemic, but I think we've gotten to a place where we're aware. One of them was a person that used to live in Nelson County. They live in a whole different state now, but God has been moving in this man's life. And he has a family, he has a wife, he has two young girls, and God's just been moving. There's some struggles he's had in his life, and he's decided he needs to just turn away from those things, and he's gotten involved in the church that his wife and his daughters were involved in, and he's pursuing a relationship there, but he's remembered that in Nelson County there was connection. It's almost like God has continually shown him that while he didn't accept it, there are way, there's a grounding he had in Nelson County, so he wants to come back and be baptized in Nelson County. And I've had the privilege of being able to pray with this man and have a conversation with him. And not that he's going to come to this church. He's engaged, as he should be, in the church with his family and with somebody that's being able there to support him. But God has shown us that God has used us, has used this county in ways that nobody even knew was going to happen in this young man's life. We're aware of this spiritually. God continues to give us an opportunity to be a part of it. There's another one. There's a family who's mother passed away of COVID just this past week. And they aren't really connected to a church that strongly, but they're very connected to a family within this church. And because of the way this family lived and because of the way they reached out to them, they said, you know what? We're believers. We know God's a part of what's going on. We know God is going to hold on to
passes away. But you know what? It would just really help if we had a pastor, someone who could pray with us, even over the phone as our mother is passing and our family comes together. So they asked this person if the pastor, me, would be willing to pray with them sometime as that approached. And of course I wanted. We got to share and we got to talk. We got to talk about how God was a part of their life. And it was a beautiful thing. And we were able to be where God was opening doors. Well, the other thing that we do is we engage others in the name of Christ. And you know, I keep sharing these things, and I'm sharing them because I want you to see what God's doing. It's not just a list of things that I've been involved in. I want you to know what God's doing and what's happening in this church. So I don't want you to lose what I'm doing and think this is just a list. But this is what happened. I already mentioned about 9/11. We, our men's prayer group, we're trying to do the right thing, and so we're careful about where we meet it. And so we started recently meeting at the church, and we meet outdoors on the porch patio part right in front of the sanctuary. And as we did, so we didn't have to wear the mask. We could talk and still be safe. And we didn't really like that. That wasn't our preferred thing because we like going into people's homes and just where it's a little more cozy and being there. But we're trying to do what we thought was right. And it's been interesting. I told you about the Well Center. There were children in this family. Bart had a little issue with that whole physical distancing thing. But twice, there was a child as they got out of the car to go into the Well Center. Diverged from their direct path and ran up onto the porch and gave me a hug before they went into class. In front of, I think one day we had six men there. All these men were there, and they come up and just give this hug.
And it's not about me. It's about God. It's about the love that we're able to give and provide for children and families.
And a reminder of that in the midst of our prayer breakfast. Then on 9/11, there was a guy that was doing some work around the church. He's walking around in the midst of our thing, and I was a little bit distracted by him. I saw him, and I didn't know who he was. And I said, hold on a second. And one of the other guys over there, we walked out together, too, and I realized who he was about halfway there. It was a guy that I'd been talking to on the phone about some work we're going to have done in the church. I called him by name, and I said, it's good to see you. He told me why he was there. And we chatted about that for a little while. I said, well, we're going back to our prayer meeting. Anything I can pray for you about it? He said, you know, today is a hard day. It's 9/11. He said, on 9/11, I lost six of my co-workers in the towers that day. His eyes almost teared up. He's grown man. 9 years. No. 19 years. Like, and he's still struggling. So, the other guy and I that were there got to pray with this man as he near the beginning of his day. And we prayed for peace. And he was able to be able to. But you know what? We weren't where we wanted to be. We were where God was. God used us that day. That's where I want us to be. That's where I don't want us to fall off. That's where I want us to be, the church. That's where I want us to be, the church that has left the building and we never come back in. To seclude ourselves, to make ourselves less than what God wants us to be. If we do it the right way, we come back in the building, we celebrate with enthusiasm and passion like never before, so we can go out and be God's people like we've never been before. So, as we continue to think about what God has done, there's more, and I'm not even going to list all that. I hope you get a taste of what God's been doing. But I want to skip down to my next point. The next point is that we are different. Mary was no doubt a changed person after experiencing the death and resurrection of Christ. Now, you have to admit that. She didn't know this was going to happen. We are a changed church in big ways and small ways. Small ways may be that we are, and I think we would have gotten this anyway, but we're about to get fiber that's going to help us have a better network connection. But you know what else was different? I've become aware now, and I'm seeking out and talking to other leaders in the church.
not simply help the secretary and I have better internet reception. How does this help us do a better job in the kingdom of sharing God's word? That changed for me as a result of my thinking and where God has put me. And it seems like a small thing, but it can become a big thing. Now, a bigger thing, even initially, is the footprint that I believe God has allowed us as a church to have. Facebook. You know the geography right now of people watching, how much area is covered by Woodland Baptist Church this morning? It is amazing. And the number of people that are viewing that often are more than what we regularly had in church before all of this happened. But another thing is pretty awesome. There's two people here with me that went with me on a mission trip, I think I mentioned this last week, to Austria, along with our director. I promise you, none of us would have gone to Austria if it weren't for the pandemic. Because it was a virtual mission trip. It only took 45 minutes or so. And it wasn't like we actually got to be there in person, which would have been really neat. But if it hadn't been for the pandemic, we wouldn't have done that at all. And we got to see what God is doing on the ground in Austria through a church called Wolnegasse. And we got to talk to people there, and they're going to, in return, have a mission trip here. And we're going to get to share what God's doing here. And we're building relationships. Woodland Baptist Church now has a footprint in Austria. Tell me God is not blessing us and using us in incredible ways. It's exciting. We are engaging others in the name of Christ. We are receiving God's blessing. We are being changed. But you know what else? Just like Mary had to experience the process that she was going through, we got to do the same thing as a church. We need to view what we've got now as an opportunity to grow and experience God has blessed us with. There are a lot of people that want to talk about the evil, and evil does exist. We do not ignore it. Don't pretend it doesn't. It's there. If we start pretending that it isn't there, it doesn't make it go away. The evil is there, but when we focus so much on the evil and give evil more credit and more talk time and more discussion than we do the God who is our Lord and Savior and Creator, we're not doing it the right way. So even in the struggle, even in the challenges that we see as something that could be turning us upside down, God takes that and turns it into something beautiful if we're willing to look at it. So that's how we need to process what we're going through right now. We have a calling that's more focused. Our worship is not to be taken for granted. We need to know that we're stronger together. We need to stay spiritually aware and know that God is sending us to those in need. So I want to go back, and this is how I want to close. In verse 17, it says this. Jesus said, "Do not hold on to me, for I have not yet returned to the Father. Go instead to my brothers. Tell them I am returning to my Father and your Father, my God and your God." Jesus told Mary, and I shared this the first day we came back and worshiped together outside. Jesus told Mary, "Don't hold on to me like you tried to before you came." And he said that because he had been resurrected, but he needed to go back. And Mary, I don't think it was just a sense of he said, "Don't come give me a hug." He was saying, things have changed. Our relationship is changed. Our relationship is growing. Things are different now. And the same has to be true for us. I don't want to go back in the building the way we were before. If we do that now, we are going backwards. Because that's negating everything God has tried to teach us and show us and lead us in the past several weeks. That's not something to be upset about. That's something to get excited about. So I pray that's what we will do. We are far from normal. But as we move back to something more familiar, I'm asking that all of us will desire something much more, much better than things being the way they were. I'm asking praise to you. And as they do, search it.
how you're part of that. Maybe it's something specific about your family. Maybe it's just something about you and your relationship with God, but I tell you this, if we do what God leads us to do, it's going to enable us to worship God better. It's going to enable us to be stronger together. And it's going to enable us to be used by God to make a difference in the kingdom. Let's pray. God, you are amazing. You are doing so much in our midst right now. Give us eyes to see. Lord, I talked recently this week with somebody about us being able to have your eyes. And Lord, I pray for that for us right now. I know we can't just pray that once, we have to continually ask for that. But help us to see our lives as you see it. Help us to see ourselves, our work, as you see it. Help us not to allow Satan to tell us we're lesser of a person than you created us to be. Help us to see the needs of others through your eyes. Help us to see those that disagree with us through your eyes. Lord, help us to see those that are hurting through your eyes. Lord, help us to see our enemies through your eyes. Help us to be more and more like you so that people, when they look at us, they don't see us, but they see you. And that their lives may be able to be changed as well. This prayer we ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
Who don't really embrace change sometimes. And this has been a time of change. And we're going to continue to change because God calls us that. So it's time for us to trust in Him. So we're going to sing Him 447, Trust in Him. Stand up. Come on, guys. Engage. Words on the screen. Let this be your prayer that you're ready to trust and obey Him today.
celebrate that. Let's be excited about that, but let's not give that more focus than we give God himself. God wants to do something in your life today and tomorrow and every day this week. Let's be open to that. Let's give him credit for it. And let's let him use that not only to bless our lives, but all those around us. Lord, I thank you for each and every person who has been able to be a part of worship today. But as much as this worship has been wonderful and great, and a move that may be back towards a new sense of normal, help us to never be satisfied, even with the new normal. Help us to continually want to be able to reach out to the adventure, to the excitement, to the anticipation.